Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. This is our ninth series of our webinar. We have an interesting topic today. It's all about retail trends, behavior, the consumer behavior, and the strategies. So, as you all know, that during this lockdown, there may be so many shops across the country, the worldwide, and even e-commerce was trying to reach out to customers, and for many reasons even they couldn't operate. So this present situation has created a requirement of the entire change of the retail operation. So you will definitely hear from the experts today what kind of changes are we expecting, how the whole system is going to change. We at Small Enterprise always wanted to educate SMEs on various changes, whether it's retail or logistics or banking and finance. So we come out with various subjects every week. So I'm sure that most of our attendees have been watching us quite religiously every week, and I'm really thankful for the whole team at Aspire are eager to see you all on all Saturdays, and thank you for coming. Today we have eminent speakers, panelists, moderators. So I'm going to introduce everyone to you. So let me just take the whole process today. I'll just take you through the agenda today, then I'll take you what Small Enterprise is all about and why we are doing this. So while we are waiting for the sessions to start today, I would like to introduce the program, the agenda. So give me a minute, let me open the slide for today's program. So the panel discussion for today is headed by the Director of Retail Association of India, Dr. Hitesh Bhatt. And I'm going to introduce all the speakers quickly, but then Dr. Hitesh will invite each and every panelist. So you'll know who they are and their profile, their experience, and the interest in being part of this event. So hope you can see this. So the topic is going to be the new retail trends, behavior, and strategies. And the moderator for this panel discussion is going to be Dr. Hitesh Bhatt. He is the Director of Marketing and Communications of Retail Association of India. We have panelist Ms. Neetu Bansal. She's a thought leader, retail. And we'll have Ms. Sudha Sarin, who is the Vice President, Marketing and Corporate Communications at Power2SME. She'll be also joining us. Mr. Rohit Arora, he is a spiritual business guru at Transcanization, is an IIT alumni, and also Mr. Avinash Kaushik, founder of Revex Ventures. So these are the four panelists and the panel discussion moderated by Dr. Hitesh Bhatt. We have two other speakers on an extremely interesting topic. Mr. C.R. Rohit Tahalramni, he is a taxation manager at ClearTax, one of the leading, GST, the compliance portal in India. And Mr. Shivaram Anandaramaiah, he is the founder of Retail Gurukul. He's also a kind of expert in retail business. He was with Tanish. So I'll definitely give an introduction to each and everyone as we go. So the crux of today's business is all about, or the topic is all about giving you insight into retail business. Panel discussion, the strategies, and what is the model going to be in the coming days for the market and for the consumers as well. So how to adapt digital strategy for your retail business, best practices on safety, how to gain from ongoing hyperlocal, and the changing consumer behavior. Very interesting topic. So I'm going to take you through the agenda quickly. So after my the introduction session, it's going to be Mr. Rohit Tahalramni, who is the taxation manager at ClearTax. He's going to talk about e-commerce, which is the need of the hour for retail business. So he'll be taking you through that, followed by the panel discussion on retail trends and behavior and strategies, which will be moderated by Dr. Hitesh Bhatt and Ms. Neetu Bansal, Ms. Sudha Sarin, Mr. Rohit Arora, and Mr. Avinash Kaushik will be the panelists. Followed by the panel discussion, we have Mr. Shivaram Anantharamay, who is going to talk about planning for the next 90 days of retail SME, the inventory, customer service, and staff. This is also a very critical topic session for all the SMEs here who are running a business, especially a retail business. So please be there till the end of the session. It's going to be quite interesting for all of you. We can guarantee that. And let me take you through the platform, what Small Enterprise is all about. So as we speak, most of the people are quite familiar with what Small Enterprise and what we've been doing for the past many years. Small Enterprise is a product or flagship portal of Aspire Media, a company which was launched in 2009. But Small Enterprise was launched in 2010. When we looked at the market, we found a gap where the market needs a platform for SMEs especially to learn. And we found that there's so many magazines, so many media, so many newspapers where they don't have a specific publication or a platform to educate SMEs. If you look at SMEs, they want to know about marketing, they want to know about banking and finance and logistics and technology. So we came to a conclusion that we should start this platform, help them understand how to do their business and how to streamline their business. So we have a large pool of experts across the country who are domain experts in technology, finance, and logistics, and so on. So we have the help of all these people, and we have an excellent editorial team who comes up with topics every month. So here I'm just going to quickly take you around the Small Enterprise, especially Aspire Media, the company as it is. So we will take you through, and give me a minute. Let me open this slide, which is company profile quickly, and the various products that we come up with under the platform Aspire Media. So I would say after we launching, we were a bit skeptical how the market is going to react to such a platform, because there is no entertainment, there is no gossip, there is no political views in here, purely learning. And we know that SMEs are not such segment who would like to go to a classroom session. No, they will not. So how do we help them learn? How do you help them learn about their day-to-day operations? Yeah, thank you. So Aspire Media is a 10-year-old company. Our flagship portal is Small Enterprise. We have a portal called smallenterpriseindia.com, which is created to help entrepreneurs learn about technology, logistics, insurance, marketing, finance, budget travel. We also have content for startups, how-tos, automotive, and so on. So it started in 2009. The portal was launched in 2010. So we have an online platform for small businesses called smallenterpriseindia.com. We have the magazine print and digital, which is now getting across to a lot of SMEs. We also give the print version for subscribers, and a lot of digital edition is going to many SMEs absolutely free. And we are also on Jio platform, which gives access to 250 million subscribers across India. So we have a club, we have an awards for startups and SMEs, a conference, email blast. We have 1.6 lakh SME database across the country. So a lot of brands use our platform to reach out to SMEs with the kind of help the SMEs are looking for. So we do online surveys, a webinar is another platform. So we have an industry event for specific, whether it's automobile or pharmaceutical or chemical engineering. So we have specifically tailored so many events that come across now. And consulting is another division headed by ex-KPMG, Mr. Dr. Krishnakumar, who is going to drive the whole consulting division with the help of our experts. So this is how the magazine looks like, the cover. We always have different stories every month, whether it's technology or banking. So we cover the cover image, and everything will be created accordingly. Smallenterpriseindia.com, the portal. And talks about all entrepreneurs. We have success stories, women entrepreneurs, startups. So it's a power pack or very interesting read for anyone who would like to know more about how to drive their business to the next level. So our target audience are not only metros, but we go to tier 2, 3 and also the villages. We reach to a pretty good segment of SMEs across the country, whether it's across the states. We have a detailed breakup which you can get to us later on. This will be shared in our video as well. So whether it's manufacturing or service or IT or FMCG, various segments, to startups, to SOHO, to small business, medium, marketing heads, IT, finance, everyone reads small enterprise now. So while I was saying, the digital platform is on Maxtra and also on Jio News, which has got about 250 million to the Prime subscribers. So pretty good reach, have more than 55,000 downloads every. Now let me get into the first speaker. I would like to welcome Mr. Rohit Sahalramani. He is the Indian from India. So the topic that he's going to talk today is all about e-commerce need of the hour for retail business. So Mr. Rohit is a seasoned tax professional with more than 4 years of experience in direct and indirect taxes. Experience in advisory services for overall process improvement for clients, finance and non-finance functions. Currently working on managing GST advisory and software development.
Okay, hello. Thank you so much, Mr. Dojo, for this introduction. And I would like to first of all congratulate Aspire. They have been able to take us online with such a great experience of this event that I'm really glad that I've been able to be a part of this event. It's really a special kind of, I've taken up other webinars with other speakers and other events, but nothing is as compared to this one. So it's a very nice platform. So I would like to start with my presentation. We at ClearTax are trying to simplify the financial lives of Indians. As we know, there is so much of complexity in all the tax laws and so many laws. So that is the motto of our company. And today we'll be talking about the e-commerce part. E-commerce, as we all know, is now the need of the hour. This is an unprecedented time. We have never seen such a time, and we hope this kind of time never comes again. But we all know that businesses are hardly hit, and the way the businesses were being conducted has changed to a big way. Everything has gone electronic, and so we have to consider taking our business electronically. Like e-commerce, I'll try to cover about what is e-commerce, the benefits, challenges, how should we go about it, and how can we at ClearTax can help you. Okay, so just for a few moments, I would just like to talk about the electronic commerce and why is it the need of the hour for the retail businesses. See, it's like an evolution in the sense, I like to relate it with film industry. Like in 70s and 80s, the heroes used to have, like, I was not even born that time, but the heroes used to have a certain kind of style. They had that enigma about themselves. That would make them hit. Then came in 90s. So in 90s, we had the era of the chocolate heroes and romantic and everything. Then came Hrithik Roshan in 2000, Kahona Pyare, and dancer, like the actors, the heroes were very good dancers. And now six packs and everything. So the way industry is changing, whoever is trying to come up new, their fitness is going to be so much of importance, not like what used to be in the earlier time. So right now, even the businesses are going to change. The way we are doing business, it is going to change. And also, like, for so long, everyone has been at home. Everyone has changed the way that they were, buying things and all those things, all those habits. Like, the penetration of e-commerce was very less. Like, it is still very less in India. But due to these circumstances, like, we have seen that elder people have learned how to use WhatsApp. They have also now learned how to use the e-commerce platforms to order and get their things, whatever they need. So it will be of no surprise that after this lockdown is over, we'll see a huge surge in the sales. be done by e-commerce operators like on Amazon and Flipkart and all those things. So retail businesses need to relook at how they are going to do their business, how they are thinking of going ahead in the near future or even, okay. So that is why e-commerce is really the need of hour for retail business, and the way e-commerce operators are doing, I'll cover that later on, but just to give you a brief, the Swiggy and Zomato, who used to deliver only food, have now enrolled few of the grocers and the retail stores on their platform, and they are delivering a lot of things. So it will be of no surprise that we see different kind of e-commerce platforms, different businesses going into e-commerce. And if we don't prepare, in this business world, it is going to be, if you do not prepare for what is going to come, you will perish. So this is like, there is no need to say that e-commerce is all right. So it is of it is not a question that if we should go on e-commerce or if we should not, but it's a mandate. It's a mandate for all the retail businesses to have their e-commerce presence. Okay. So I will basically start with what is e-commerce. It is a very brief question. Everybody knows about it, but just so that we are on the same page, I would like to start with this. It is just buying and selling products or services using the internet online. Transactions are taking place online. You are able to sell, people are able to buy. Everything comes under e-commerce. So it is a very wide topic, and it can be bifurcated on the basis of either parties or the business model that that the business is undertaking. Based on party, it can be bifurcated as a B2B business like IndiaMart, Alibaba and all, they are giving us the platform for that. There is B2C business. B2C is business is directly selling to the customers. We have a few electronics and all few websites who are directly selling. Like you can go on their website and order. So that is B2C. Then there is direct to customer. Like it is same as B2C. The companies are directly selling it to customers without any interruption in between. Even the payment gateways and everything is owned by them. Then there is customer to customer, like we have for OLX and this Quikr and OLX kind of thing. eBay is also one of the big player in that. So that is also a part of that is also kind of e-commerce business. And also there is customer to business, like right now we are seeing cars24.com and all those things. Like even customers are able to sell to business people. So also kind of model that is coming up. And based on business model, it can be like retail. You can just retail it from your website directly to the customers. And then there is drop shipping. The general term used for that is e-commerce operator. Like drop shipping is nothing but there is an e-commerce operator, like we have Amazon or Flipkart, who would take parcel from you, drop it to the customer. Even FedEx and all are helping in that, and they're also giving you a marketplace where you can list your products. Then there are digital products. Digital products are one of this is an example of digital product that we are online gathering together as a part of AirMeet, and they are providing us services in exchange of a few, some amount that we are paying them. Then there is services. Again, services can be, recorded webinars, recorded sessions, or recorded, like Udemy and everything that we are able to see. Services are also sold online. And also there is subscription model where you can subscribe to something and, Audible by Amazon, where you can just subscribe to it and you can access their platform and buy whatever you need and you can access them. Then crowdfunding is also an interesting topic, though not mature in India, but crowdfunding is something like, we had one case of crowdfunding with 251 mobile, where a person would take fund from crowd to be able to supply to them. So that is also a mode of electronic commerce. Basically in India, we have mainly been used to think that e-commerce is mostly about selling through Amazon and Flipkart. Of course, that is a very convenient model, but there are other ways that you can you can work on. So these are few of the ways in which e-commerce works. Okay, so this is what is e-commerce and kind of e-commerce platform. Now, briefly, the benefits, everybody knows that benefits of e-commerce are going global, like you can sell it to anywhere. One of the most important thing is about the minimized expenses. Minimized expenses as in you can have a place anywhere. You can have your warehouse anywhere. Like I know a person who was in a prime locality in market of computers business, And then he started doing online and his business started to boom. So he went out of that place, which was a retail hub, and he went to a place that was little far from that market. But as he was selling online, he did not care about that. And he saved rentals in like lakhs of rupees a year. So e-commerce can, you know, minimize your expenses. It was just rent, not just rent, just transportation and everything. If you see, there is a lot of benefit in terms of expenses. Okay. Then there is no time barrier. You don't have to open time, close the shop on time. You are always online. You can get the order. You can have your own SOPs. Like every day up to 10, whatever orders we are getting, that will be shipping the next day or the day after. You can have your own SOPs without having any time barriers. Okay, then easy marketing and branding. Everybody knows how much a hoarding costs and how much a YouTube ad costs. Or a Facebook post would cost you. So branding and marketing is also very easy, and also you can target the specific people who you think would be required. Like in Facebook, you can go and select the age group whom you want to show your product and whom you want to boost the page to. So branding and marketing is also very easy, and it is the best way to sell a niche product, because for niche product you need niche audience, and few of the audience would be in the same city, like we are in Bangalore. So there would be few people who would be living near my place, and it will be very difficult to get more people of that. So using e-commerce, I can, you know, easily get to anywhere across the globe. Then customer connect is also very easy, like shooting out constant emails. You can set reminders and all those things. Because you have customer details, you can connect with them easily. Like we get birthday messages from various companies, Amazon and everything. So you get more information and you can connect with customer easily on a call itself. While in a retail business, if the customer doesn't come to your store, it will not be that you will be having their contact details. So that is one of the most, like, there are so many benefits. These are one of the few benefits that according to me are the most important ones. And along with benefits, there are challenges for e-commerce. First of all is the data security and privacy. You know, going online, you are prone to a lot of hacks, those things. Like even the company like Zoom, which has got state-of-the-art technology and security, they also got security concerns. Many companies are not allowing using Zoom for meetings. So this is also, you know, going online, you are also prone to that. Then there is the biggest challenge that we face is waiting time, cancellation and returns. Because I've ordered a TV, for example, and I get it, I get a better offer in the store tomorrow in the neighborhood. So I might go and cancel the order. And this is a big challenge for e-commerce people, and mainly in textile or fashion industry, you will see returns is the most common issue. But that challenge can also be solved. I've seen people challenging, solving that problem by selling it on, like, selling the best goods in best quality and best packaging, so that it reaches the people also reaches the customer in the best possible, you know, the form. Then tracking and updating orders is the biggest challenge. Like when you will start, you might have 10, 20 orders a day. Then it might grow to 100, 150, 200 orders. Then tracking each and every order, you know, most of the e-commerce operators provide you a tracking platform, where you can track all your orders, whatever is the status of that order. But sometimes when you have already prepared for delivering that order and at the last moment it gets cancelled. So that kind of challenges come a lot in this e-commerce business. Then again, the logistics in small town is a very big problem, for which Amazon had come out with a very good solution where they connected with India Post. These are postal services for delivering. You know, innovative solutions can give you a lot of solutions for your clients. Then working capital and investment cycle is also a little different, because some vendors, some marketplace people pay weekly, or it's not just a challenge. Working capital can also get better if you are selling on credit mostly. On e-commerce platform or selling online, you might get it the working capital cycle might be reduced for you, and also the investment. Then the biggest problem that I have heard from businesses is about the payment and tax issue. Like they get a huge file with thousands and thousands of line items, and they don't know what is deducted to them, what is being paid to them. They just know every week an amount is credited to their account, and what to file about that. Like even the tax returns, there are so many items. What is B2B, how much is B2C, and all those things. There is like huge issue. This is the biggest, that is why I've just kept it in bold, because this is the biggest challenge for e-commerce operators. When you're trying to sell through e-commerce operators, not just your website, okay? Because when you are getting it on your website, then you might be able to make it in such a way that the classification of the orders is done in your friendly manner. Then this is the most important question now. How to go about e-commerce business? There are a lot of ways. Of course, I've tried to get it in a proper order, but of course, the order can be up and down based on your experience, based on your network, and based on the infrastructure and everything that is available to you. This can go up and down, but according to me, this is the thing where you can start thinking of, like, how do you start from a scratch? Like, first of all, you will have to choose the e-commerce model. Like, what model are you thinking of adopting? Okay, like I can have my own website. A friend of mine had a sari brand, and he used to just do wholesale and trading business, and he had some depots in various cities across India and a few showrooms. Then he started his own website, but he could get so much of traction on his own website, though he was able to sell good amount, but he still had to go for e-commerce operators. That is the best and the easiest way in India by far by now. But with someone like my another friend who was very tech savvy, and he had his own website, and this was in 2009 or 10, and he had the computers business, and he had his own website and started taking orders, and that time he was able to get some traction. But at that time also he was registered with other e-commerce players, but still his website was able to get a lot of orders and everything. So it is always best, it will be cost saving for you to get the orders on your website, but it is very difficult to get the traffic over there, because people will be like, on Amazon there are hundreds of people and there are thousands and lakhs of products now. So a person will go there for buying anything. He'll not be thinking like, if I want to buy a laptop battery, I should go to Amazon or which other site is going to sell it. So that is the benefit with them. There can be other, like if you have network, like if you think of Aspire Media, they've got a good network, so even their own website can do wonders about businesses. Like Small Enterprise magazine, that is amazing. Like I think I've heard many people reading this magazine. So you know, they'll be able to do that, their online services by themselves. So it is, the first thing is to decide how, what mode you would want to go for e-commerce business. Then it's about training and development, like how to track orders, how to keep the finances, and how to, you know, track the deliveries, how to track the charges, everything. You need a good amount of training and development, not just you, your whole team who is going to take care of all these. It is not like the normal retail business ki koi aaya dukaan pe, you have sold them and got the money, everything is over. It is a whole new kind of business. There is supply chain, there is another vendor management, everything is very different for e-commerce. So you need to start with training and development of yours and of your team. After that, you need to think of the infrastructure, the IT infrastructure that is required. That is where security concerns can be handled. But it is, along with the IT infrastructure, also the supply chain infrastructure, like what kind of vendors you would want to deal with. Because right now, even COD is something that was introduced only for India, and that is a different kind of infrastructure for many companies. So how do you want to go about it? That will also be impacting what kind of infrastructure that is required. Do you want to be want to store the goods and sell directly, or do you want to keep it on order basis? Like you'll have a minimum quantity, but you can get it easily from your vendors. Or what kind of vendor network you have, that will also depend upon that. So setting up the infrastructure is also going to be a consideration and a very important part starting your e-commerce business. Then legal setup is also one of the most important thing, because when you have a small store, not everything is visible and not everything is recognized. But when you are online, your presence is known to everyone. Like, you don't know when you'll start growing like anything. So you have to keep up with the legal requirements based on your business. Like, e-commerce operators file this TCS return that you have to claim in GST. And that is an extra, not extra, but it is out of deducted out of your own sales, whatever you have sold through them. And you can claim it and use it. And even you can get it refunded. If your GST liability is not that much, you can get it refunded. So legal setup is also something that you have to be very, very careful about. Because as I said, it is a different kind of game. So you need to think of that. What kind of setup do you want? You would want to have a private limited company, or you would want to have a partnership firm, and how would you like to have it? That is also very important. Then marketing, once you have your legal setup ready, then you'll have to market. And marketing, based on your audience, you can think of how do you want to do it. Google ads are there. There is Instagram ads. There is Facebook sponsored, like Facebook boosting. There are a lot of ways that you can market, and that is what you have to do next after having a legal setup. Then, you know, nothing is going to, like, so much, as much as you want, you can plan, but nothing is going to give you the real feedback until you test and launch it. Launch, you can start launching with a normal, like, very few number of people and market it to very few number of customers. And as you get feedback, you can keep on improving and thinking of, okay, if this infrastructure is not going to work, how do I do that? Or what kind of more trainings are required for my team? Do they need a, you know, there are certificates of digital marketing that are available in the market. So do they need that kind of training and all those things? All those things you have to think about. I could not have gone into more detail in such a period of time, but I hope this is one thing that will, you know, give you a stepping stone of how do you want to get ahead with that. Now, how can we help you? All the services that we showed you except for marketing, we can help you on a lot of services. On ClearTax, we have a whole range of services available for businesses. It is one of the best tax filing platform. Someone asked me, it is very difficult for private companies to do online tax filing and the compliances. We provide you all the kind of services. We are best income tax and GST filing software. And along with that, if you want trademark registration, that also we provide you. If you want any kind of advisory, that is also something that we provide you. But if you want to just keep on filing your returns, like, you can take our software and you will have a constant support from our CAM team. So this is, and just to go a little deep, we have two kinds of services. One is about launching your business, wherein we have a lot of tax experts like me. There are many experts like me, and there is a whole team who will help you with advisory, the business incorporation, legal requirements and taxation registration. Everything will be done. And while you are doing that, for managing your business, we provide you a lot of services like accounting services, payroll services, periodic business compliances, like there is PF and whatever is applicable to you. And tax returns, obviously you can use our software. Even though, like, the cost of the software is also not much. Like, if you'll see, it will be available to you for a very little price. You can connect with us on, I'll give you the details after this. You can do that on your own, and also you'll have an expert assistance available over there. Okay, so will be available to you with a good team. Like, if you know how to do that, but you feel scared that, okay, we might be able to handle these return filing, but what if some question comes up? How do we handle that? So you do not need to worry about that. There are a lot of people, there are many CAs in our team who are there to help you. So if you have just small problems, you can buy this software, do all your filings, and ask the experts for doing that. Because again, I've taken this example in the media event as well. And right now also, I would like to tell you, before a few years, like, ClearTax was launched in 2011, like a beta release was done. Before that, everyone needed a CA to file the returns. After that, salaried people, like, from 2011, you just upload your Form 16 and you will be done with your income tax returns. So nobody thought that we could file By 2014-15, we were a big company and we were a big name in income tax filing. Same is the thing that we are trying to do with GST. If you will think about like the transaction, I told you about the challenge. One of the challenges is this one, payment recon and tax issues. Amazon gives you a list of like an Excel file of merchant transaction report. At the end of month, we'll have thousands of records. You can just import that file into our GST software and you will be able to see how much of it was B2B, how much of it was B2C, how much credit notes were issued, B2B credit notes, how much B2C and how much is receivable. So all those things can be done on ClearTax on this platform itself. Okay, so I think I'm running out of time now. So these are the contact details for ClearTax. You can reach out to us 080-6745-8777, or you can also visit our website cleartax.in, wherein we have the services page, we have a software page wherein you can buy the software, you can get in touch with experts, and any kind of help that you require. We also have a feature of requesting a callback. You can just put in your email ID and phone number and we'll give you a callback. So that was all from my side. I'll try to take questions from the chat and would hand it over to Mr. Dojo. Thank you so much.
Yes, Mr. Rohit, thanks a lot. So I request the audience to click on the raise hand feature on the right side of the screen if you have any questions which you want to ask Mr. Rohit. Yeah, so or else we can carry out in the social launch. So after the session ends, the social launch will be open for half an hour. So we can go ahead and ask a question there. Without further ado, we'll go ahead and start off with our panel discussion. So let me go ahead and introduce our moderator for the day. So it's Dr. Hitesh Bhatt. He's the Director of Marketing and Communications of Retailers Association of India. So Dr. Hitesh Bhatt has been around 25 years of experience with some of India's leading organizations across diverse sections, including the retail, pharma, FMCG, automobile, petroleum, retail marketing, consulting, media, etc. He has earned his MBA from University of Mumbai and holds a doctorate in branding and retail. He has also completed exclusive retail management program from IIM Calcutta. So we will go ahead and start with our panel discussion, and Dr. Hitesh will be introducing our panelists for the day. So go ahead, Mr.
Thank you, Dojo. Thank you, Rahim. Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here today with all of you, and an extreme pleasure to be amongst the four experts from the retail and the other industries that we have here with us today. I'm privileged to moderate them today, and I take this pleasure to introduce them one by one. So first we have Ms. Sudha Sareen, Senior Vice President Marketing and Communications, Power to SME Private Limited. Sudha Sareen is a seasoned communications professional with over 2 decades of experience in managing strategic communications for organizations. She is responsible for lead generation, opportunity creation, corporate communications, customer marketing, creative services, and marketing operations at Power to SME. Before joining Power to SME, she has been a Managing Director of Public Affairs, IPAN and Dalton India, CEO at Good Relations India, and CEO Senior Partner at Ketchum Sampark. Sudha has a master's degree in English literature from Miranda House College, Delhi University, and a diploma in marketing and strategic planning. She was also a core team member in setting up the Women in Business Forum and a mentor with the National Entrepreneurship Network, and has helped build many brands. She has been visiting faculty at the Indian Institute of Mass Communication and MIT School of Marketing. Welcome, Sudha. It's a pleasure to have you amongst us today. Then we have got Neetu Bansal, thought leader in retail. Neetu Bansal comes from a variant background, hailing from a family business and stints with various corporates and handling sales and marketing. This exposure to various verticals has created a patchwork of experience in business development, customer relationship management, SOHO segment, MNC, and mid-size organizations. Ms. Bansal is the director at Citraya Innovations Private Limited. Citraya is a MarTech product company partnering with brands to engage their partners and customers through a mobile channel. Ms. Bansal brings in her market and business knowledge to productize the offerings while addressing the expectations from market. Ms. Bansal has engaged with brands such as Bangalore International Airport, Columbia Sportswear, Kurlon, etc. to extrapolate their brand experience in the mobile space. Additionally, she has also worked with some international brands such as Vogue, Burberry, D&G and Titan partnership campaigns, Ray-Ban, Oakley, Vogue. Welcome, Neetu. It's a pleasure to have you amongst us today.
Thank you, Hitesh. Thank you.
Yeah. Now we have Mr. Rohit Arora, spiritual business guru, founder, become CEO. We've got Avinash Kaushik, founder of RevaWex, WC Brazil and Africa and Verizon USA. I move to now Rohit. And Rohit, brands are now directly working with retailers, and be it Kirana shops or QSR outlets. How do you see the supply chains getting permanently restructured in FMCG and retail?
See, now there are multiple online digital platforms that have come in, because there was a traditional model of, you know, the modern trade, general trade, and supplying stocks to warehouses, and then hub and spoke model supply to the general trade stores or any other retail store, right? Now what has happened is, because of this home consumption, at least in this phase, we are seeing multiple different businesses all jumping on to the model of creating, you know, inventory as a service. You know, the Swiggy's, Zomato's, or even most of the, you know, e-commerce platform, everybody is looking at moving the inventory closer to the consumer. And the 30 million strong general trade stores are becoming like a power hub for such distributions. So you see now very, you know, the large companies which hold the supply side as well as the demand side, they're all investing in connect with retailers, especially the general trade merchants, the mom and pop Kirana stores, because these are in the neighborhood stores closer to the consumer, and it's very much essential to be connected in order to tap the market opportunity.
Rohit, your viewpoint on this, please.
Yeah, I completely agree with that. Actually, if you look at the traditional model of the retail, where you had, as you correctly established, there was a modern retail, there is a distributor in between, there is a sub-distributor, there is a retail. And this is not going to be a long-term model, because as the consumer behavior is changing quickly and fast, and this pandemic has actually influenced that change even more, inventory is now a very key thing in the whole process. And inventory has to be the closest to the customer. Now, this does not happen if I do not read the demand side of the customer right with the customer. So therefore, retailer who is just close to the customer side is extremely important when it comes to the functional needs of satisfying his daily inventory. Now, suppose a retailer acts like an inventory hub for all the small and medium, so for all the customers in that area, then that becomes a very great source of input for me as a corporate, me as a principal, to deal with that inventory kind of a situation. Otherwise, dumping used to happen, and that dumping is now not going to be sustainable. Inventory costs are going to be extremely important, and lean structure, direct connection to the customer, is extremely important. That can happen only by really spreading the spreading your reach to the customer through the Kirana stores across that hyper local kind of a scenario. So it's not going to be a very strong thing. If you look at it, the Kirana stores around the locality, the kind of emotional connect that they have with the people there, including the societies, is unbelievable. If they can actually consolidate that data and provide, and maybe the principals can help them do that networking, that data along with the consumption data is a deadly combination to ensure we reduce all of our inventory costs across the chain.
So Neetu, my question to you is that, you know, we know that COVID is going to be, you know, taking in more and more customers online. And what are your views on the future of the brick and mortar, retail outlets? Is there going to be a drastic transformation there, or will they survive, or how will they survive at all? Because the customer is moving towards online, you know, that's where the trend is, and that's what we are discussing now.
Absolutely. See, we all know that, you know, the brick and mortar companies are the businesses are the ones which have been most impacted, whether they come in the retail format or any other format. Now, the way I see things is that, let's take the example of a dentist. Even he is a brick and mortar, but he's a service provider, but he's a dentist. At some point of time, you will continue to go. You will go to a dentist. You will go to a salon for a haircut, right? How will they attract a customer during these times? Is the first thing you're talking about is their safety, their hygiene, etc. Same concept is what immediately is what the retailers will also, the traditional brick and mortar companies are going to be doing that. They are going to attract customers immediately after lockdown, talking about how everything is hygienic, how they are maintaining the cleanliness, how they're following the protocols, etc., etc., and such. But having said that, the customer is still going to hesitate, obviously, to go to the customer to go outside. And here we were talking about that retail businesses have to start looking at getting online. Now, getting online does not always mean that it has to be an e-commerce store. We're talking about we spoke about Kirana stores, right? This is an example about how some of the Kirana stores have actually started using WhatsApp to communicate with the customers and talking to them and telling them when products are available, orders are accepted over WhatsApp and kept ready, and the customers have to come pick it up. In fact, even payment options are now there. Earlier, where they were not very open to online payments or digital payments, they are now quite open to taking the digital payments. And so that's a good way of talking about going digital. That's way. Now, the other part of it is that aside from all of these things, companies, business will obviously look into how do I get into an online store presence. One very interesting concept which I really loved when I was here listening to some of the other speakers was that, you know, traditionally today, retail stores, they sell through the physical stores, and if they have anything, they use online to do most of their marketing. Okay, now businesses will always have to go where the customers are, and today the customers are online. They're not available physically. So the way one possible future can be the opposite, that retailers will now start selling online, okay, and using their physical stores, their brick and mortar stores, to actually create that human experience, which is not going to be possible on the digital platform. So the human interaction, the immersive experience, is going to become a more lucrative for a customer, and that's very possible in a physical store. So that means marketing may now actually move on the physical stores, and the selling will now happen on the digital stores. So that's I love the concept that there is a possibility of something like this happening. So yes, businesses will move online. Brick and mortars will change. They will still continue to be, but they will change. Maybe their function changes. What they're going to be offering to the customers changes. At the same time, there will be a mix of other businesses which will continue to be brick and mortar, but they have to incorporate all the new protocols which is required. Where today, for example, hygiene is become the primary need. Safety, health safety become a primary need. So you have to cater to that first before you actually start selling your products and services to a customer.
I'll just get back. So my next question here would be to Sudha. And Sudha, what transformation you anticipate in B2B e-commerce post-COVID scenario? Will this completely restructure the industry or existing supply chain? How do you feel? What are your views? How will the supply chain be affected with this? If I'm audible.
Yeah, you are. Hitesh, one of the things I think for all of us will agree here that what we're experiencing right now is unprecedented. This has hit businesses, it's hit families, it's hit professionals. Life as we know it will emerge to a new normal. And I think that's something we all need to be prepared for. There is no playbook that exists where leaders can go back and have a reference to say, if we are faced with this, what kind of solutions we can adopt. There is no crystal ball that exists that can show us the way or show us how the future will emerge. But one of the things that we have experienced as a business at Power2SME is a few things. One of them has been the need to be nimble, the need to be extremely agile and extremely ready to innovate and reinvent. I think that is true of most businesses right now. For example, a lot of the people who have been our clients in the textile business have all gone on to doing masks and kits and, you know, body masks, etc. Yeah. Because of COVID times. If I was to talk of us, we're essentially a business that works with manufacturing SMEs, and we provide them raw material at better costs, we provide them timely delivery, we provide them better quality. Along with this, we also provide finance through our NBFC and our other company, which is partnered with a number of NBFCs. We also have an MRO business. Now, very quickly, in a matter of literally a week post the shutdown, we had gone into COVID products and we have gone into COVID innovations. We've also understood that the supply chain behavior has changed. And this is something which is not dyed in wool. We will see changes as we move along the stages of business opening and business being ready to operate at 33%, 50%, 70%, 100%. You will see these changes. So again, I say the ability to adapt will see us through. The ability to transform will see us through. Supply chains have undergone a change. A couple of pointers that I'd like to highlight here. Changes are being seen both on the supply side and the demand side. Where demand is concerned, the dependence has increased from a few to many. Nobody wants to be in the same situation they found themselves in during lockdown. No one wants to today depend on just a few suppliers. They want to ensure that they have developed stronger linkages, varied linkages, to ensure that the cycle is not broken. There is also a fear in the market of shortage of supply and shortage of demand. This has obviously been created from the lockdown, and we are seeing various sort of behavior patterns or buying patterns emerging from this. Diversification is something that you are going to see. We will need to, as SMEs, be ready to prepare ourselves in terms of newer testings, newer certifications, forming newer linkages, especially because the global supply chain has been totally, totally disrupted. If you are seeing, and you will see this in auto components, you will see this in electronics, especially because their dependence on global supply chains has been very, very strong. Yes. However, we see an opportunity emerge here. The opportunity of what I call a national India brand. If you see, Taiwan has done this wonderfully and Peru has done this wonderfully, right? So you will see changes of behavior, changes of consumption. And I think we all need to understand that we will see a certain amount of fluidness in the market in terms of newer patterns emerging. you will see market behavior change. Even if you see in terms of trade financing, there has been huge bottlenecks. The bottlenecks continue. Banks are continuing to remain risk averse. NBFCs are not very, very positive about lending. I mean, these are all challenges that we are seeing, which will also impact supply chain behavior. Because finally, if you want to have more inventory, you need to have more financing. So all of these are complicated. I think you will see a very, very fluid situation, which will possibly stay over the next 3 or 4 months. However, one of the things that we have heard, whether it is from the banks or whether it is from government or whether it is from our own experience as part of SME, is that we will need to all innovate. And we will all need to think outside our comfort zones and step outside our comfort zones to try and understand how businesses will emerge, re-establish, and stay strong in post-COVID era.
Sure. So, Sudha, you know, articulated it very well. My next question again goes to Neetu and subsequently Rohit. So, Neetu, for traditional retailers, besides considering e-commerce as a new sales channel, are there any other tech solutions that will help them in their business to run more efficiently, generate new business, etc.? Your views on that, Neetu?
Thanks, Hitesh. Rohit has already touched upon how e-commerce has its multiple challenges. And if a traditional retailer who has never sold online before, they may not be ready when it comes to setting up an e-commerce setup. In fact, in the current situation in Middle East, the government has allowed organizations to sell both essential and non-essential products online, but they are not giving permission to traditional retailers who have never sold online before to start selling now. That means the permission is only available for people who have earlier been selling online, and they can continue selling non-essential products too. Why is this rule that has been implemented is mainly because the thought is that the traditional retailers who have never sold online before will not be ready. Readiness is the key factor that is the reason that they are distinguishing this. Now, what does it mean to be ready? The same thing applies here today in India also, is that traditional retailers who are not sold before will not be ready. And I think Rohit has covered a lot of questions around that. That before, when you're setting up an e-commerce store, you have to think about what kind of model. We're talking about drop shipping, C2C, B2C, B2B, etc., all of those things. He spoke about return policies. What about the delivery, last mile delivery? How are you going to be delivering it? You need to have that system in place. Okay. In fact, interestingly, not all your products may sell online. You need to even, the product segmentation itself is going to change. Plus, of course, your online payment decisions, then the government policies, your GST certifications, etc. A lot of decisions have to be made when you're going on an e-commerce platform. So before that, there are other things traditional business retailers can actually think about doing that. One of which is using your simple, the simplest one is to use social media before you jump onto the e-commerce stores, which is basically your Facebook store, Facebook shops. See if you know, there are a lot of organizations, a lot of mom and pop stores, a lot of businesses which are larger who have succeeded in selling through social media. Why does this work for you? One is that through this, you don't have to look at finding the market. There is already a market with about more than 2 billion people coming, unique people coming in every week. At Facebook, it's a huge market that you can target. Okay, so you don't have to sit and create that market for you. So it's a good place for you to start with. using, that's one option that you're looking at. Okay. Then I already gave you the example of WhatsApp. There are a lot of businesses that I know about who have been selling or at least marketing over WhatsApp before the current situation also. So this takes on a bigger role. It's, yes, it is meant for smaller organizations where there's a limitation of the number of customers that you are talking to as such, but it's very much possible today. There is a beautiful example of a brand that was trying to sell mayonnaise. And what they said and how they use WhatsApp to market. So they asked their customers to go online and enter, share their mobile numbers. And along with the mobile, they also asked them to share a picture of their fridge. What are the items that they have in the fridge? Okay. Now, after that, real-time chefs were actually, they took the items that they have in the fridge and they created recipes for individual customers using the items that they have in the fridge and that particular mayonnaise. That was a huge success for them. So simple WhatsApp, lower investment in online, and they were able to actually increase an amount of the demand for their product. The next thing that I would look into are technologies like mobile apps, or more than mobile apps, actually web apps. Simple web app solutions, which will create your online stores, and you will be able to connect it with a payment gateway and quickly set up store without setting up the entire e-commerce store's front end. Okay. Why all? And then, of course, you have your Amazons and Flipkarts. That's the next step that I would advise somebody to look into. Now, why all of these before you reach the e-commerce store is the way your consumer or your customer behaves with you when he is in your physical store is going to be different from the way he responds to you on the online store. Your online customer is going to have different behaviors. I was talking to somebody who was again selling ethnic women wear in Ahmedabad, and I was, he has never sold anything online. But if somebody comes to his physical store, he knows how to make sure that they land up, they go back having purchased more than what they have planned for.
Sure, right?
But this may not be happening there. So so these are the things before we get onto the e-commerce store, before you plan your entire own exclusive e-commerce stores.
Sure, that was a very exhaustive explanation and insights, Neetu. Rohit, your views on the, for the traditional retailers, and besides e-commerce, what are the new channels and what are the tech they can use? Your views on that and how, they can be benefited with the new technology, if at all it is there.
So basically, the technology solutions that Neetu was suggesting are quite being used nowadays. And when it comes to a localized, see, as I told you earlier, it's about hyper-local. And it's not just in retail. It is actually being spread across, even broadcasting, even newspapers. All these are now extremely important to understand what is the behavior of my locality. If you can make yourself a specialist in your life, in your local area, which requires three levels of understanding. Understanding the buying behaviors of my people over there, and universe is only localized. Second, how do they behave in different seasons, in different festivals? Again, very localized. Third, what is the kind of a behavior in terms of the relationships I can establish with me as a retailer and them as a consumer? Now, majority of the buying has to be on the proactive compassion level. That means I already know that what is that you used to buy. And this, suppose, I still remember a long time back, during our childhoods, there used to be one vegetable vendor will always come and say ki aapke yahan pe itna bhi bhaji nahi hoga. Now, how does he know? So that is proactive compassion. Doing the inventory checks at the local level is very easy. Now, local retailer, no matter what business he is in, he has access to the data of his people around. He also has the buying behavior there. Now, there is a lot of data crunching that can be done behind based on whatever buying happens, if I can capture the data. So therefore, I remember one of the very interesting guys over here, around my area only.
And this is second generation coming. The second generation holding one large shop. The second generation guy has done what? He has just simply created one Google form. In the Google form, he is only picking up the orders and connecting with everybody. He just ensured that he uses his database, connects with each and every person in the locality around. So he just made a list of all the buildings that are there, and he ensured he reaches each one of them personally. And he connected with them emotionally, he established a relationship with them, and then taught them on the phone that how they can place order at any point of the day, and even when the shop is closed. So as Nito was suggesting earlier, selling is happening online. The selling is happening online. Now, when you have an exhaustive list of data with you and only a few people, but the consumption is huge. So whether it is baby clothing, whether it is baby essentials, everything is happening over in the hyper local. Imagine one store can actually operate without people going there, only delivery boys, and data being collected through two important sources. One is the Google form, which is actually giving the data. Second is the relationship. Now, if the relationship does not exist, Google form will fail. If relationship exists, Google form is not there, then there will be a mess on WhatsApp. So the relationship entered the equation. Now, how do you establish the relationship? It is a new era that is taking root. But today, there was an era then where transactions were important. That means I am transacting with you, you are transacting with me. It is one to many transaction. That world is over. That is a world where you were focused on selling.
Sure.
Then came the era number two, which actually focused on relationship. That is, I am selling this last one point. I'm just selling by establishing relationships and trying to retain and satisfy the customer. And then has come now the level number three, where it's the era of collaboration. That means now I'm working with you and I'm talking to you and collecting data, what you need. So my buying is also becoming better because my relationship is collaborative rather than just one-on-one.
Okay, well said, Rohit. Sudha, my question to you would be, how, you know, the B2B e-commerce and the correlation between, you know, helping the small businesses in terms of volumes or market penetration, how that can happen? You know, what role do you think that B2B e-commerce will be playing here?
I think one of the things that we have seen is a readiness for SMEs and MSMEs to adapt themselves digitally. And I will give you a case in point. As a part of what we do at Power to SME, one of our marketing campaigns is run under something called SME Transformation Camps. And we work with a number of associations, trade associations, which really work with manufacturing SMEs to try and bring our value proposition to them. We've been trying to see if we could also introduce webinars for a while now. And you will not believe it. I think till date, from the day COVID actually, the shutdown happened, we've possibly done about 12 to 13 webinars. We're doing about 3 webinars a week. And our attendance is massive. I've had a panel which I was on just before this, and I've moved to this panel right after that. So that is something that we're seeing. I think if you look at B2B e-commerce, earlier, it has always been a mix of online and offline. essentially because in B2B, your ticket sizes are way larger than in commerce, right? And therefore, the offline interaction has been quite intense in terms of negotiation or trying to sell them raw material of another brand, which may be pretty much similar to the brand that they want because of availability, et cetera, et cetera. I think one of the changes you will see is that the SME will understand the need to be digitally a lot more connected. The second thing you will see is you will see changes in supply chains that will happen. You will see them wanting to hedge their bets and to develop linkages which are multiple because of the complexity of setting up an entirely new chain, especially in terms of global supply chains. That is the second change that you will see. I think the third change that you will see is that this is something that has come up quite a lot, that you may actually see a lot more collaborations that may be happening, which was not the case earlier. You will see a lot more collaborations happening in SMEs. You will see a lot more partnerships happening in MSMEs. So these are really the three changes that I see happening. In terms of B2B e-commerce, it's quite self-explanatory. I mean, finally, it depends on what kind of B2B e-commerce this is, whether it is store in store, or you are having an e-marketplace, or you are having a listings platform. I mean, it depends on really what all is happening. But I think the need to try and develop a strong digital presence is something which has been recognized, which is possibly the need of the hour. And that is something that you will see happen. However, you know, I mean, that is all great. But for the SME, there are two major things which really impact them. One is, how does business open up? How do I get permissions? How do I run and get my factories back to roaring 100% life? And then how do I manage to get my payments, which are stuck, whether it's with government or PSUs or private players, and how do I get the finance? These three major issues for the B2B SME sort of stays, and that doesn't go away.
Thank you, Sudha. Avinash, my question is to you. Sudha spoke about collaboration, and you know, this is the word that COVID has brought in, and in most of the webinars across, people have said that collaboration is an imperative today for all of us, and that goes without saying, which was not the case prior to COVID. And now everyone is dependent upon each other so much in the supply chain. And for me, the supply chain is the value chain I'm talking about, right from farm to fork, not only from the producer, the wholesaler, the distributor, the marketer, the retailer, but I'm talking about the financer, the manufacturer, the other allied people. So it's a interwoven web that has become more imperative for collaboration today vis-a-vis what it was prior to COVID, because right now we are talking about survival. What do you think from an SME perspective or an FMCG perspective that, you know, today the QSR outlets or the smaller retailers or the SME retailers need to collaborate on, and what is the need of their hour, whether it is technology or whether it is this? Because see, right now they are in a dilemma. What should I do? Finances not available, manpower not available, raw materials or finished goods not available, harassment from XYZ authorities always there. So they are in a dilemma kind of a thing, and here is where we are giving them these solutions. But what is your view and your perspective on that?
See, I think the SME retailers, these guys have been our backbone, right? But
yes,
they are the ones who are keeping our economy alive, keeping I would say, in your home you will get internet data stream, you get if you're working you get cash flows, it's a cash stream. But FMCG or grocery is another stream that continuously comes to your home for consumption, right? So that's happening. So these general trade stores, Kirana stores, mom and pop Kirana stores are very much alive. These are run by one person or two people. So they don't have any people constraints. And the supplies they keep are all essentials, pretty much essential. They don't keep anything fancy. So Kirana, mom and pop are not the ones which are disrupted. It's the other guys who are actually disrupted, and they're betting on Kirana guys. Kirana is actually the savior. So from large companies which run wholesale supply chains or large e-commerce and online ordering or offline ordering platform, all of these guys are now betting on Kirana mom and pop. It was evident even before COVID, but COVID has made it inevitable that you got to go leverage them, otherwise you don't survive.
Sure.
Yeah. So that's what I see. I see Kirana guys very, very safe and sound. It's the other guys who are going and trying to gather data, gather technology, you know, offer POS machines or offer, collect data from all these general trade stores, try to package and see some analytics and then figure out what is the basket, behavior in different catchment areas. So that's what's happening. Large companies traditionally looked at Nielsen and two, three other platforms. In Nielsen panel only, it's not dependent on retail scenarios. Nielsen is more on, stock in stock of scenarios from large companies. That's how Nielsen collaborates data. But now, general trade store data, nobody has captured. That's an opportunity. That is why big guys are after general trade stores. And so I see them very safe. I see them, the people who are keeping us alive.
Sure. Thanks, Avinash. So I started with a 1 minute introduction, and we have come to the fag end of our webinar. I would request our experts to give a final concluding remark. Maybe if we can limit for a minute or so for everybody's benefit. A 1 minute concluding remark from each one of you. We'll start with Sudha, and subsequently Rohit, Avinash, Neetu, and then we'll go to Neetu. Yes. So we'll start with Sudha.
This has been hugely insightful for me personally. Hearing all our experts speak, give wonderful pointers. There's been lots of conversation on supply chain. There's been lots of conversation on supply chain in terms of the Kirana store. I have to give you a personal example here. And all my vegetable shopping has been done by my local Kirana guy who's been supplying it to me. And as Neetu very rightfully said, digital just does not mean going online. Also means using WhatsApp. And that's exactly what's kept my houses, kitchens running and, feeding us. So I think one of the things is that there will be impact on business. There will be impact on all our personal lives. We're seeing that impact. I think there will be impact that will possibly, and Rohit may be able to give us a perspective on this, the fact that he's a spiritual guru, that, we will make personal changes within ourselves. We will make personal changes in the way we do business. We will make personal changes in terms of all our planning. Earlier, when we submitted plans as individuals for our company for the year, it had a year's perspective. In today's day, your immediate plan will be breakfast, your midterm plan will be lunch, and your long-term plan will be dinner. And that's really what you're going to work at. The faster we turn our heads around this, the faster our bosses turn our head around this, the faster the investors turn their head around this, the faster the government understands this. This impact is going to be felt. It's going to be felt deep. It's going to be felt wide. I think for each one of us, We need to learn the skill of how to stay afloat. We need to learn the skill of how to handle pressure in times of uncertainty. And I think if these are the two or three skills that we live by, we will all survive. And that's the only thing I have to say. It's the toughest thing. It's the toughest thing to tell your teams. I don't know. It's the toughest thing. They've never possibly had a boss who said, I don't know. But you sincerely don't know, and you take it. Your planning is smaller. Your window of opportunity is smaller. Your window of getting results is smaller. And I think that is something which, for me personally, has been hugely difficult to get my head around. So that's really what I want to say. I wish you all well. I wish your families well. And I hope in happier times, we will all come back with the same panel.
Thank you, Sudha. I think next.
Since our anchor's gone, he's not there. Maybe you want to go next.
Mr. Avinash can go next, and Mr. Rohit can go next.
Okay.
So,
Rohit, want to go?
Yeah. Okay, I'll go. Thank you, Sudha. It was really insightful. Actually, one of my friends, actually, when I when this lockdown happened, actually the things were happening in China. And he actually sent me a message which actually resonates with me a lot right now. The message is, Mother Earth was infected by a virus called as human, and it has got the first vaccine called as corona. And it actually changed the perspective with which I looked at the whole things. And it's actually a very important fact for all of us to understand that now is the time when, if we do not understand that in others' growth is our growth, in others' growth is our growth, and it's the mutually, if all of us grow together, then only we can grow, we will not be able to run anything, forget business. And business will have to now move from a capitalistic thought process, what is it for me, to a process where they think that in my balance sheet, profit will need to have planet and people into it. It just cannot have only profit into it. If I cannot show empathy, if I cannot show love, if I cannot show serving attitude, I will not be able to survive as a business.
Sure.
So everyone, as I said, was for selling, era 2 was for retaining, era 3, which is now taken birth and COVID has actually made it happen, is to make this world a better place. And if we all can work together, then only this can happen. Thank you very much. And I think it was a beautiful gift of time that you gave. And I love the discussion because very intellectual points came in, which will add to all of our lives. Thank you very much.
Neetu, please.
Thank you. So, this has been a very insightful discussion. I mean, I got to hear from Sudha about the B2B aspect of the supply chain piece of it. I got to hear from Rohit on the spiritual journey that one needs to also look into, and talking about from Avinash, a different whole perspective about how organizations are have to relook at their segments, right? For me, the bottom line is that everyone has to change. Right, not any or any person or any business is thinking that things will go back to its earlier self. That is going to be a huge blunder. Things are going to change. Changes may be different for different organizations. The extent of changes may be different, but they are changing. That means everybody has to pivot. Everybody has to change. And this is not the time to fear. This is a time to think and act. So jo dar gaya wo mar gaya, that's a situation. So think. Act, but do act. Don't wait ki things will go back to normal, and if I don't do anything, everything will be the best. So that will happen. So that's not the situation. We have to think, work. Ultimately, think agile, think community, think individual, think innovation, think technology. But whatever it is, do think and act on it. That's about it. Thank you very much.
Sorry, Avinash. I told Avinash, but Sorry. Please go ahead.
So I would say there's a phenomenal opportunity for Indian SMEs.
One is, you know, there are other cross-border countries which are flowing, you know, shifting manufacturing destinations and even IT and so on. So an equal number or even 10 times more opportunities are flowing into countries like Vietnam, Bangladesh, and even Pakistan. So there is a lot of work that the SMEs need to do with the government to create the infrastructure. So to enable these opportunities to come to India so that whatever we have lost in the economy due to this pandemic, we can recuperate and make up for it. So we have all seen how, you know, Shenzhen has transformed over 10 years. Probably, you know, that kind of phenomenal growth can be seen if India as a manufacturing economy can grow. That apart, there is for all founders and people who are leading businesses, entrepreneurs, this is the time we got to be super open to collaborations and working together. There are opportunities everywhere. This is the time when even if you call up your vendor, your corporate client, a large company will always be open to listening to you and explore opportunities of figuring out a particular solution for a problem, right? And then this is also the time for you to get digitally equipped, because always we keep technology or digital transformation aside, and we are always focused on getting the revenues in. So this is the time you can spend in getting yourself, your company, your staff, everybody digitally transformed. Use tools, applications. So India is a very strong startup economy. I run a startup accelerator. So there are so many technologies available, including all these artificial intelligence, AI, ML, that we talk about. So even I was thinking, you know, it's going to be there like 5-10 years down the line, but it's all happening today. Our startups are so good, top notch, that they can tell what's the order coming, what is your next order, where is your next order coming in, be it B2B or even consumer businesses. So Indian startups are amazing, and they have very good technology solutions. So always feel free to reach out to tech hubs like NASCOM or even the accelerators that I run. So there is scope for SMEs to leverage technology to grow.
Sure. With this, friends, we come to the end of a wonderful webinar. I thank Sudha, Neetu, Avinash, and Rohit for giving this opportunity to me to interact with all of you. I thank Dojo also and Aspire Media also for creating this wonderful platform. And till we meet next time, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all for the panel.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Mr. Hitesh, for such a nice moderation. And thanks, Ms. Neetu, Ms. Sudha, Mr. Rohit Arora, and Mr. Avinash for being a great panelist. So we'll go ahead and introduce Mr. Shivram. He's a popular consultant since many years now. He has worked with over 350 small, medium, large, and extra large size jewelers all over India. He focuses on helping jewelers increase their profitability using best of the retail practices. He was earlier the merchandising head at Tanishq, and his favorite area of profit improvement is with vitamin M is inventory management, which is the main topic for the day. So he's the founder of Retail Gurukul, which is a consulting training and training for retailers and manufacturers. So over to you, Mr. Shivram.
Yeah. Thanks, Dojo. Thank you, guys. So I also want to ask, how many of you have a database of your customers, right? It could be mobile phones. I heard a lot about how, Google Forms and things like that. But simple mobile phone numbers, right? How many of you are there? How many of you have, if you have database, just type DB, right? You guys must be faster than me, right? The fastest finger first. That's what at least we heard from I learned from Amitabh Bachchan in my younger days. I don't know whether he's still on the ABC platform, right? Okay, right? So tell me. Okay, so do you have inventory? Let me ask you a more broad-based question. I'm assuming there are a lot more guys with inventory in your warehouse, right? That's really my favorite, right? While you guys type I for inventory, I'll give you a little bit of my time at Tanishq. I was there in Tanishq when we just about were wondering whether we will be there next day morning, honestly, and I'm not joking, right? So we were getting a lot of awards for marketing, advertising specifically, but we were losing money left, right, and center. So we've been there in those very, 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 very tough times. So what you really see today, those success stories, and I think $900 is the share price. That's the result of all the hard work that, the 15 years the brand and its team has put. I see some people saying, I've got database. I see some people in textile business. Come on, guys, you should be faster than me, right? So the third question I really want is, how many of you have got sales staff? Whatever kind of sales staff. You could be a salesperson yourself, right? So either you have inventory, or you have sales staff, or you have a database, right? I'm assuming a combination of these three must be there for every business, right? So I come from a point where frankly we have worked with about 350 and odd. What I learned from the FMCG guys and the garment guys, right? Small, medium, large, extra large, and multiple XS large. So my clients are like 2 crore rupees to 8,000 crore rupees. But all of them really have two things in common, right? How many of you want to know what are those two things? Just type two. And I normally work with a lot more tech challenged teams, right? You guys are also tech experts, right? You're talking about artificial intelligence and machine learning, right? That will be going out of above the head of most of my teams, right? So, I mean, let's get a little more serious and things like that. And I have my what I call as two favorite bottles, right? Take two bottles of Bisleri, right? Put one water, put every house I presume has, put some kumkum, right? Nothing very very high tech, right? Just put kumkum into it. Now tell me what percentage of your stock is slow moving. I want you to type a percentage. Especially if you are a retailer, if you are a manufacturer, probably you are a lot more, inventory focused, right? But I really want to know what percentage, any kind of retailers, right? I know a little about retailing. I don't know really much about, manufacturing, right? What percentage of your inventory is really slow moving? What percentage? What percentage of your inventory is slow moving? Come on, you should have some numbers. 70 to 80%. Oh my God. Okay. Right. Slow moving by any definition. So when you're saying 70 to 80%, clearly there is a challenge, right? What I see in my business, right, where gold is actually unlike many of you. I hope you can see this, right? There's a sticker here. It says 66% is saleable stock, 34% is dead stock. That's why it's in red color. Red means you're bleeding money, right? And in an environment where we don't know how the market will respond, etc. Sorry if I push this point to you guys. I'm a guy who will talk directly and from the heart. Hope I have your permission to talk like that. We are committing suicide, harakiri, right? If you're borrowing money from the bank at 10%, 12%, right, and you're stuck with 50, 60, 80% of inventory as dead inventory and slow by your definition, not even my definition, right? My request to all of you is please type, right? And I have learned a little bit on subconscious mind in the recent past. So the moment you start writing and, typing it, it goes into your mind, right? So I really want you to type that, right? So you clearly have a challenge, right? 50%, 80%, not acceptable. Not acceptable any day, not acceptable all the more in today's environment, right? If you guys agree with what I'm saying, you know, please type yes. Right? Not acceptable today to have 50% of slow moving inventory, right? And the reason, and I've also, apart from working in Tanishq, you know, I used to be part of watches, part of the Titan watches, that is, right? Part of the reason is we are always pushing inventory, right? The manufacturer, the maybe the vendor offers you some good deal to the purchase department, the guy is buying it in bulk. Now that the inventory is there, the manufacturer, the manufacturing plant, if I can use the word, is under individual targets. The manufacturing plant is producing X, Y, and A, B, C, D, E. Now I have a sales team. I see some salespeople here, right? Now your job is to achieve targets. So you're pushing it. You're doing schemes. You're doing discounts. There are lots of discussions, I think, on discounting, right? And then it is getting stuck at the retailer, right? I might, if my value chain, right, is what is the majority of the situation, please just type agree. If you don't agree, please type I don't, right? But if you're saying that yes, that is the typical flow of our in across industries, though I really come from a jewelry background in the last 20 years, right? So where I believe, and this is something that I learned in Tanishq, and that's what I've really been implementing across, really is we moved from a push to a pull system, right? It's crazy, right? I worked, we had a complete paradigm shift. I used to think, I got introduced also, I was the Tanishq head of merchandising. We had approximately, at that point of time, I think we had 10 lakh customers. Right. So at home, I had three women. I used to say that my mom, my wife and my daughter, I can't understand them. And in my job, I'm expected to understand 10 lakh women. Right. And make product available at the price that they are willing to pay. And across 150 retail outlets at that particular point of time. Right. And still have conversions. Right. So clearly, and we did a lot. It was basically a pull system, which is currently what is my really my specialization. Because for me, the point is that if you're sitting on 35% dead inventory, right? I'll ask you another question, especially if you're in the lifestyle space or something like that, or right, maybe you are also in other spaces, right? Tell me, do you have 100% conversion, right? In the jewelry space or in the lifestyle space, you know, you typically have a 65% conversion. But since I see people from different industries here, I want to ask you this question, right? Do you have 100% conversion in your showrooms, right? If you have 100, type 100. If you don't have 100% conversion for your category, right, please type the conversion which is for your category. I know there are some, I may be a multi-brand outlet, multi-category outlet. But if I am supplying, let's say, agarbattis to a supermarket or a grocery shop, if there is a customer who is coming into the showroom and she's asking for agarbattis, or I don't know, maybe one specific variety, is that conversion happening to 100%? Right? If you're still there, please type, yes, what's the percentage of conversion for your category? Guys, let me push you a little bit, right? It's a very different experience for many of us, right? When you're in a physical environment, we can see body languages, right? Here, all I'm seeing, not even the face, right? We're just seeing a name, and you could be anywhere in the country, I presume, right? So my request to you is, and just now the last speaker was saying you need to have empathy with your customers. I'm requesting you empathy to the speaker, right? Not easy to talk to a blank screen. So you see, you're all putting in 60%, 80%, 90%, right? I'll also extend this a little further because, you may be a SME selling B2B, right? If you are an SME selling B2B, right, tell me what is your conversion. Anybody who has a sales team, tell me what is your conversion. I'm modifying my pitch, to suit the audience which is around, right? Tell me what's your conversion for any sales team. Yeah, 10%, okay. Anybody else? 10% is a little bit of a shocking, right? 50%, okay. Right, I'll go with the 50%, right? Now, here you have a situation where 50% of your inventory is dead. And here is a customer who has come to buy a particular type of product, right? And you are having a 50% conversion. I'm not talking about a scenario where I'm an impulse buyer. Even if I'm an impulse buyer, I am ready to pay hard-earned money to buy your product, right? And here you have all of you saying that I've got 50%, 70%, 10%, 90% conversion. That's what I mean by saying that, do you wish, and I have another slide of mine, you are in a what is called as a red ocean. If you ask your typically, all of us will complain, you know, market is down, competition is high, customer is not spending, etc., 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 etc. Correct? Right? If you agree with that, please type yes. So I have a whole bunch of reasons why I am not able to sell. That is reflected. I'm taking me as an example, but I'm assuming my entire team is in that pipeline. So I have a situation where I have a bunch of reasons why I am not able to convert, and at the same time I have another equally critical issue where 50% or 60%, whatever is your number, is a set of products which is sitting dead, right? In my industry, I have called it as golden furniture, right? Because we sell gold, I say we are sitting on golden furniture. So really what I'm saying is, does it make sense, right? Does it make sense to you guys, right? Why is it that at one end you are sitting on a 50, 60, 70, 30% dead inventory, and on another end that you're having less than 100% conversions? That's really the core of the product, or core of the problem, right? And typically work on my consulting assignments, I'll try and explain this with a very simple chain, right? It's a bunch of colored paper clips, and then there is a rubber band at the very beginning. If you were to assume that this is a train, right? The train speed, efficiency, fuel efficiency, output, productivity, profitability, whatever you want to say, ultimately, initially depends on the speed of the engine, the horsepower of the engine, and the capability of the senior leadership to take the rest of the teams along. If this team is not in a position, and as an SME, much more critical than a large organization, right? As an SME, most of the decisions are at the boss level, right? And if you are an SME, the family has invested money in the organization and has given you the responsibility to run the business. So the question is, are you in that position to, efficiently run the business? So there is an issue with the staff. There is because your staff is not able to convert. There is an issue with the inventory because you're sitting on dead inventory, right? And then there is a database which is, I will also say, maybe it's also 50-60%. So my dojo, you can tell me how much time we have. Based on that, really is where you can move your train forward, right? Just a simple example, markets have been down. How many of you, especially if you are in the retailing space, right? How many of you have connected with your consumers?
Ten minutes is good for you, Shivram, Max?
I'm not able to see, but I'm seeing only my this one actually.
Yeah. Is 10 minutes okay for you?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
If you're able to see me, I'm fine by that.
Yes,
how much time I would have?
10 minutes.
Okay, cool. Right? So I'll close in 10 minutes, right? So my question to all of you is, these three legs, right? Whether it's a consumer or a consumer database, inventory management, and your sales force, right? That is clearly what can help you, move forward, right? If you say these are the three, consumer, and I mathematically, if this is one, this is one, this is one, and it's operating at 100% efficiency, then you should really get 100%. But the moment you multiply it by 0.5, and then 0.5 is what is available, and 60% is your conversion, and you don't really have a good customer relationship. I'm not saying you don't have a relationship, right? I'm saying that do you have a good loyal customer base, a program, etc., 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 then only all of it really, really will fall in place. My experience with most retailers is really, one, they are not even aware, right? Forget about acting on it. They are not even aware of the stock rotation of their products at the gross level or at the category level, right? So if you have not been doing the category level, stock rotations, identifying, fast movers, identifying slow movers, that's really, I mean, I would definitely say that at least during my time, one of the critical rockets, which helped us to move from where we were to a completely new level, right, was really our ability to manage inventory management, right? We learned a lot, we did some special projects and things like that. So, but that's clearly what took us from where we were to where we are, where we were able to take. And I'm sure the brand has now, multiplied and successful across multiple areas of success. That's something which we have been able to implement it across our clients. Work on it. That's why I keep saying that, work with the owners, the business owners, the senior management. That's really the team which should be open for challenges. Corona is done and dusted. Life is completely different. And for me, this litmus test, right, especially if you are a retail store, is, have you connected with your customers in the last 45 days? And not necessarily for selling. Leave about the staples and the essentials where people have gone to buy because I needed it. I have half a dozen apps to buy on every other online platform, or my local Kirana shop is willing to supply to me and things like that, right? Tell me, what have you done to, I see that, somebody has connected with the consumer, somebody has connected with the consumers, right? So what have you done beyond, the first step? Okay, listen, I'm here, how are you? How is Corona, how has been the impact of coronavirus? What's the next step? What's really the next step as far as the consumer is concerned, right? In many markets, it's still shut. Some of them are again getting shut and things like that. So that's one area which you can probably relook at. The second area, which of course, as part of our coaching programs we do, is really on inventory management, right? How many of you, just let me get a sense, how many of you really know what percentage of your products come from your best selling range? What percentage of your sales comes from these so-called best selling products? Do you have a list of best selling products? If you have a list of best selling products, do you know what percentage of sale? Okay, fine, right? So if you have got that 70% of it is coming from 70 or 80% from 20% of best sellers, the question to you really is, go back and see whether those 20% of your best sellers, right, 20% of your range, is it available consistently, right? It is not easy, right, to make sure that the 20% of your bestsellers has been consistently made available across all the sales points, right? If you have been able to do that, hats off to you, really, right? It's not been easy. especially when it comes to especially in again consumer side, sizes, colors, fit, and things like that, right? So that's the second part. The third part really is the staff, right? If the conversion is 50%, 60%, 70% post corona, right, when the market I presume will be much tougher to handle, previous selling skills will no longer be sufficient. Previous selling skills will no longer be sufficient, right? So what is it that you as an organization, especially if you are in the B2B2C space, right, with a large sales force, right, how equipped they are to be in a position to sell more efficiently, right? Sell more efficiently, sell more profitable products, sell more, other kinds of products, right? So these are probably some of the quick takeaways in a very short session like this. If I think we got another 5-7 minutes, if you got any questions that you want to ask, I'll be more than happy to answer. Over to you, Jojo. So in summarizing, there is an opportunity in inventory management. Honestly, 50, 60, 80% is really a concern from my point of view. Of course, when I come from the jewelry background, everything is in crores and crores of rupees. So inventory, there's clearly an opportunity, especially when markets are down. We are not in a position to have the right merchandise. Staff experience, expertise, and selling skills is the second area. And the third, of course, is, you know, how do we connect with our consumers? Yeah. Thanks to, all of you guys. Dojo, you can take it and we can answer a few questions.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. Shivaram. It was really wonderful. I think you should be one of those training gurus, and the entire thing, you made people write a lot. I mean, I've never seen people writing the numbers and so much of involvement. Fantastic. Thanks a lot. We really enjoyed. I think those kind of typical that gurukul feel that you have brought in. Okay.
It's a learned skill.
Yep. Absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you very much. And in fact, I hope that today's session was fantastic and everyone had a great learning and great takeaway. Thanks to Vadhwani Foundation, who was a support partner for this, who has been with us from the last, 8 series till now, and we are going together. We have a very strong, content coming up in the coming weeks and months. So to all of you, that we are going to have a mega event in July, which we will let you know what is the kind of, size and scalability that is going to be. But thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Shivaram. And to all the speakers today,
reach out to me.
Yep, absolutely. Thank you very much to everyone. Thank you. Thank you, all the speakers, Dr. Hitesh, who has been a great, moderator today. Ms. Neetu Bansal, Ms. Sudha Sarin, Mr. Ankit, Mr. Rohit, Mr. Avnash, everyone. I mean, thank you. Thanks a lot. And also, Mr. Rohit from ClearTax, it was a great session that you had in the beginning. So thank you all once again. Any questions, anyone would like to ask any questions, please reach out to the experts at the launch. The launch is something, it's a new experience for everyone. So once you get in, you will get to know the launch, you will get an icon after the session gets over, not now. So after the session gets over, you'll get to the icon on top of your screen, the social launch. You can go there, you can go and grab it, share and, network with anyone. So probably you'll meet the experts there and ask questions, whatever you want. So thank you all once again. Thank you once again. And we look forward to see you next week. And next week is going to be a fantastic session on logistics. It's more of technology and logistics. So it will definitely be of a lot of interest to everyone. So stay tuned. We will be giving a lot of info in the coming days. So please register. So today we had a fantastic crowd, about 350 people registered. And I think over 200 people have attended today's webinar. So it is fantastic, and I'd be loving it. So please join us and make this success and a lot of learning for everyone. So thank you very much.
Thanks.
Okay. So we're just going to play a quick commercial on Vadhwani. So just stay tuned for a minute.
The Vadhwani Advantage Program, helping small businesses grow. Do these questions keep you up at night? how can I grow my revenues? Should I look at new products? Need a good lawyer or an accountant? Who can help me with funding? Badhwani Advantage can help. How do we do it? The Badhwani Advantage program provides access to a complete ecosystem of partners to help SMEs like you grow. From finding a good accountant, to helping you get a working capital loan, or finding new customers, or even charting out your strategy to expand globally, we have it all covered. The Badhwani Advantage team and its vast network puts their rich knowledge and experience at your disposal in the form of content assets that include do-it-yourself guides for quick impact, self-assessment tools, videos, case studies, and more. And all this is available for free to all Badhwani Advantage program members for life. In addition, we are available to help you chalk out a personalized transformation growth plan that puts you on a hyper growth path. Badhwani Foundation is a non-profit organization started by Dr. Ramesh Badhwani, a Silicon Valley-based billionaire. We are currently present in 22 countries around the world. We do not charge for any of our services or for our platform. Service providers on our platform are all reliable and charge reasonable rates for their services. All we want from you is an investment of your time and a commitment to achieve hyper growth in your business. The Badhwani Advantage program provides you access to verified business services and lead generation platforms. We also give you access to unlimited tools and do-it-yourself guides to help you streamline and grow your business. You also get access to the Badhwani Advantage transformation team for personalized support for your business. So what are you waiting for? Join the Badhwani Advantage program and help your business soar.
So that's about it. Thanks all. Thanks all to the audience. And thank you, Mr. Sivaram, for a beautiful presentation and your engaging exercises and your examples. Really loved it.